So, when you're both mic, okay.
Yeah.
We're mic, we've done ourselves.
You guys
are straight in, straight on.
So have you been doing a lot of this? We're in Toronto.
Yeah, this is the never-ending film because it went to Cannes.
Mm-hmm. Which
was in May. Then it went to, did all the UK stuff. Then it went to Toronto.
Yeah.
Now it's here. Went to New York. Yeah. It's like the never-ending film junket.
It's longer than any of the other films.
But it's actually nice because we really love this film, yeah. So it's nice.
Don't
that
mind talking about something.
You do want to promote the ones that you love.
So you shot other. I guess you've been shooting things in the middle between doing press for this.
Yeah. Well, you have. I've not. Yes. I've devoted my life to press at the moment.
Press and theatre. Theatre. No, I've done 3 films since Tamara Drewe.
Wow.
An independent film called Flutter, mm-hmm. and then Immortals in Montreal for 5 months, and then The Three Musketeers, which is what I'm doing now. I'm halfway through it in Germany.
So are you having fun?
Oh yeah.
I'm is this your thing now? You're going to be like the big energy guy, the big swashbuckling?
Well, if they want to put me in that category, I certainly don't mind. I'm having a lot of fun. I mean, it's just like you get up in the morning, get on a horse, and then do some sword fighting, and it's like... Brilliant. It's a boy's dream. I've always wanted to play a musketeer. So, I'm having a brilliant time.
And was it your dream, Gemma, to do the same? You got to do it in Prince of Persia.
Yeah. No, I didn't really imagine myself ever being in those kind of roles, but got to do it. And it is actually good fun, you know. I really enjoyed doing all the stunt work. I think if you're going to do that type of movie, then do your stunts as much as you can, because that's where the fun of it is.
Absolutely.
That's where the fun lies.
As long as it's safe. That's what my mother always says.
What's wrong?
I don't know.
I hear your iPhone.
Oh, my iPhone apparently is humming.
Ooh,
I've been dead.
Oopsie daisy.
It's always somebody else's fault, but...
I love it. When Stephen Frears' phone always goes off.
Always. Always goes off at the press conference.
Even in like a take or something. And he'll go, that'll be Hollywood.
Yeah. And sometimes he used to... I was on set once and it went off and he went... Whose is that phone? And everybody's too scared because he's so upset, so angry, and everybody's going, who's going to tell
yours.
Him it's his? And
it's
it keeps
too
going
on.
So I would just assume Stephen wouldn't even pay attention to his phone.
No, he's a real text messenger.
Yeah, he's
loves
quite prolific.
Messaging.
Quite prolific on the old text messenger.
So is he giving you advice what to say to HPA today on the text?
Yeah.
Be nice to them.
Yeah. Just say yes.
Give one word answers.
And smile. And smile.
So is there a big difference for you guys doing? I mean, you both did Clash of the Titans also. Mm. So, and did you have any scenes together?
No.
You didn't ever see each other in that one?
No.
No, I think we bumped into each other a couple of times.
We made friends on that one, though.
Yeah, that's how we both knew that we were going to do Tamara Drewe while doing Clash. I remember being at the top of a slate mountain.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
Yeah.
I was in my 24-carat gold armor with extensions down the back of my... You were pale white and ethereal. And we just sort of...
You were wearing your 24-carat gold suit.
And
I was pale white
and ethereal.
And
that's when we sort of was like, we're going from this to... I'm going to be a handyman and you're going to be a...
Yeah.
Little vixen.
Yeah.
Country
but it
vixen.
Is. It's like, it's completely different. It's completely different.
Yeah.
It's funny because you have to still do the same thing. You still have to act. Mm-hmm. But the whole experience is utterly different.
Hugely different.
And more fun to do the little ones, or?
No, I think they're
just
all
different.
Every job is so different, and everyone's a challenge. But I've been lucky. I've found fun in every job I've done. I've tried to make every one of them fun. So, but the thing about the Tamara Drewe,
we pretty much everybody in Tamara Drewe comes from the theatre, and we're used to that kind of mentality. So sometimes on the big movies when there's like 300 people on set, and you have no control over what it is that's going to turn out in the end, you do your performance and that's it. Whereas when you're doing a smaller thing, it's very much like being on, being in the theatre.
Yeah.
And it was really like coming home doing Tamara Drewe because it was intimate and it mattered what you did, and we had a very good relationship with everybody. And I knew everybody's name on set.
Yeah. It's so weird. I said this the other day.
But they still called me Tamsin, which is really like...
Stephen always got it wrong, didn't he?
Yeah, Stephen and the first AD Stuart, they would call me Tamsin all the time.
But it was like a little family. We just had like We could count everybody on set.
Yeah, it was really nice.
It was very sweet.
Stephen uses the same crew pretty much on every film. It really, and it means that there's a really easy dynamic on set. Everyone just gets on with it. They know how Stephen works. Mm. They all get on with it. They enjoy it. They respect him. And so...
They call him Dad.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. It's really nice.
Well, he was very proud. We had a conversation about this a few weeks ago, and he was very proud of the fact that he may be the oldest working director now.
Oh.
And it sounds like really working.
That oh, he's really, and he's unstoppable as well.
Honestly, yeah. He puts us to shame.
He
puts me to shame.
He's constantly, even when you're just with him during the day, he's always looking at the next thing to think about.
And or he's meeting somebody for a coffee, or somebody's coming to meet him for a meet. He doesn't stop.
He loves it. He really loves it.
Well, it's just, it's in him, isn't it? It's his passion, and he's...
Yeah, it's amazing.
It's lovely to see somebody like, of his caliber and his age that's still going for it. It's just... Yeah. It's a great example to us all.
He does seem willing to try just about anything.
Yeah.
You know, it's really like one film to the next, you really have no idea where he's going.
No.
I think he's going to do like 3D, like, action movie next.
I did mention to him the other day, because obviously we've done some 3D stuff, and I'm doing a 3D film now, and I said, you should do 3D next. And I thought he'd be like, off. And he was like,
But thinking, that's what's great. Amazing about him. He really... isn't like he doesn't have a game plan or anything.
No.
He just likes doing different things. That's what excites him. That's what excites all of us, you know.
Yeah.
Doing different things, not knowing what's going to happen next, experimenting and trying stuff out.
And also that's liking what brilliant. You're doing.
Yeah.
He always chooses something that he likes, and I always think, well, that's how I'm going to try and work my career is to
it
choose
really
things that
inspiring, actually,
makes you. You want to do it. You don't just want to do it for the money or for the fact it's a job. You want to do it because you like the script and something ignites something in you. And that's how Stephen chooses his
always,
work.
Yeah.
Did you guys have any relationship with a graphic novel when you chose to do this?
No, didn't know anything about it. This was the first. Tamara Drewe was the first graphic novel I'd ever read. Mm. I didn't know about that world.
No.
It's a huge culture. And lots of films that aren't about superheroes and radioactive chemicals.
There's no flying people.
Are actually based on graphic novels, and that interested me because sometimes I find those things alienating because I can't relate to them. But this was about human beings, real life relationships, and it's. And when I read Tamara Drewe the graphic novel, I was astounded at how in one little scene, one little picture. A whole page of dialogue is told. You know, expression, body, you know,
so
body language,
things.
Everything.
Yeah.
It's
even
just
people commenting who weren't even on the page. Like Beth would be narrating something, or maybe Glenn would say
amazing.
Something, and they weren't. It was very, very clever, and it just shows how clever and talented Posy Simmons is. Because I mean, these drawings are just so clever and beautiful.
Yeah, witty.
Yeah. Yeah, they're just great.
Well, you just have a sense of what a director does, I guess, because ultimately he's trying to create that same frame where there's so many things going on besides what you guys are doing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Do you guys think about that stuff? I mean, you're both young actors.
Yeah.
Do you think beyond the acting at this point, or are you still very focused?
Well, my goal is always to be a theatre director, but I just know that I can't do that until I know I have enough command. You know, I need to be able to, you know, I need to learn about acting before I can even think about directing, especially like getting someone to listen to me and go, okay, I'm going to listen to your direction.
Yeah.
So everything, I mean, I love acting. I really have a passion for it. I think I will always want to do it, but theatre is my it is, you know, it's my passion, and I've always wanted to do that, so.
I feel the same. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
You want to direct theatre?
Well, when you've done a lot of theatre, and you sometimes do a job where you see a lot of things that you'd like to do differently, especially because you do it repetitively, every night, you find certain things that work and certain things that don't, and sometimes they're a directorial choice, and the director's gone, and you're just there doing what they've left.
Yeah.
And it can be very frustrating, and you learn very quickly as an actor on stage because you repeat. You have to repeat, and you have to make it fresh every night. So you get to analyze it intricately. Like as with film, you do the scene, and you have to just go, it's done.
It's done.
Whatever I've done,
forget
it's
about
done.
It.
The door is shut,
it's
and
out of my
the
hands.
Next one is open, you know? But with theatre, you don't. So I've always thought I'd love to direct a play or a show of some kind, because I've always been frustrated slightly at certain things that haven't gone the way I would have thought they would have been better done. Maybe one day.
Mm. Well, theatre is kind of revered in England in compared to film or anything else, really. It's kind of on
it's
a different pedestal.
It's our thing that we do well, I suppose. We've got such a great culture for it, and it's something that's like cultivated as well. And, you know, it will always be there. And there's a big respect for it in England, and
And even the screenwriter of Tamara Drewe. Mm-hmm. I mean, she finished Tamara Drewe and had a play at the National Theatre.
Yeah,
I mean,
she is a playwright. Well,
incredible. Yeah, that's what she's
basically. Successful playwright. Yeah,
she's a hugely successful playwright, and her play was brilliant.
Yeah, did you see, I went dying to, for it. Yeah, what? No, what the one
at the National? Moira Buffini, her name is, and she's going to be huge. And
she's clever. She just wrote Jane Eyre, the new film that Mia Vashi.
And Michael Fassbender. Maya Kowalski.
Anyway, she must get really pissed off with people doing that all the
Alice,
time.
That's right. So did you guys both have to overcome your looks to get into the business? Was that?
What do you mean by overcome your looks?
Well, you're both so unattractive.
I've had to have a lot of surgery.
Yeah, me too.
A lot.
Yeah.
So did Tamara. So kind of.
Yeah. I mean, I had so much done. If I'd have tried the way I was before, there's no way they would ever let me in a film.
I had teeth like tombstones. And until the collagen, I had
mouth
no lips.
Like, what is it? Mouth like Mormon tombstones.
You can't do that. American TV.
What do you mean?
Well, does it make it easier? Well, I was kidding, but does it make it easier or harder? Or, I mean, in the culture of England?
No. Well, we started off in the theatre, so there's never any prejudice in the theatre about how you look. You just get the role if you're good.
Yeah.
So it's just a very different thing in the film industry, I think. But
I understand that certain roles I get have something to do with how I look. Not just, like, facially, it's just stature or everything about the way I look, like, I think definitely influenced Stephen's choice and decision to put me in the role of Andy Cobb. Mm-hmm. To the point where I completely believe it, because I look at the book when we finally got the job and looked at the graphic novel, and
you really look.
It's like somebody has drawn me, you know. Yeah. It's very, Posey, she gave us all a picture at the end of our rap and actually put our name instead of the character's name at the bottom of the picture. I have it on my wall now, and many people have gone, did somebody draw you like under a tree with your sheepdog once? And I was like, no, that's actually a character I play, but it was alive before I knew it. Yeah. It's very weird.
It's amazing. Wow.
So is it something that you, I mean, obviously you've both gone into film, so is it a completely different issue? Are the film jobs at this point in your youth, in your relative childhood of film world, about what you look like as much as anything else? Do you feel that pressure?
Depends what you choose.
It's very true, yeah.
Depends what you choose. Some films, they don't care.
No.
And some films, they really care. Mm. It depends what you choose.
Do you guys care?
I don't give a shit.
No, absolutely.
If you
go into a job because you think you look right, I think you're not going into it for the wrong reasons. You've got to go into it because you care about the character and the role and you want to know who the director is. There's so many more
but
important things.
But it's so trivial.
Things.
It's so boring.
Yeah,
if you
want to
be an actor,
acting
is a job that's not easy. It doesn't come easy. And some people are very lucky with it and get into it very easily. But if you really care about it, I trained for 6 years to be an actor. I didn't. The way I look doesn't have any reason, you know, I got into acting in the first place.
I look like an actress. I'm going to be an actress.
So,
well, a lot of people do get that. You should be an actress.
Some people
do.
There
is definitely that part of the industry that, you know,
but it's just very trivial when you really give a shit about acting. When people only want to talk about the aesthetic, it just seems very trivial.
Well, you almost feel a bit like a model walking down a catwalk if you choose to. It's the way you look is going to be your career. It's sort of. It's nice to get dirty and look ugly and strip everything away and not give a damn about how you look.
That's why it's liberating to do. Like, it's funny, since I've been promoting the film in LA, I've been asked loads of cosmetic surgery questions because my character has cosmetic surgery, right? Nobody really talked about it anywhere else. And
if you go to the back of Los Angeles magazine, there'll be like 20 pages of cosmetic surgery ads.
It's crazy. Anyway, so you know, and then I don't know. It's I can't even remember what I was going to say now about the
plastic surgery.
Yeah, since I've been here. Anyway, it just you know, it's a very strange thing that. You know, I always want to talk about the character and the story, and actually we've been asked loads of things about that.
I guess
it just seems an obsession, and it's so not it's just...
It doesn't matter. Yeah. A couple of wrinkles are nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you see that too. I mean, there are...
As an actor, I think it's essential that you have expression and that your eyebrows can move.
So no Botox for you, I guess.
Well, no, come on. It's not going to happen. It's going to grow old gracefully.
Yeah.
But being a Bond girl is kind of like, it's a boxing thing. It kind of puts you in a little bit of a box.
Only if people want to put you in a box. I didn't put myself in a box, but other people put you in a box.
So you take a role like that just saying, I like this character, I like this...
Yeah, I really liked Strawberry Fields. I thought she was fun. I thought she was witty. I was honoured to get a job at that point in my career because I was a student, had a lot of student debt, I was a girl in England. You know, it's like, don't take it too seriously. It's just, you know, and I really had a good time on that one. And people have always said to me, but the Bond girl curse, you're never going to get work again. And it's like, well, no, I have worked again. And you just have to make choices that... You know, if I continued to play those kind of roles all the time, then yeah, you limit yourself. But if you careful and think about what you want to do, then you know, do a bit of theatre, do an indie film, whatever. You know, then there's no reason why it should be
in that world, because you've got to keep your eyes open and your fingers in lots of pies, and see that there is
and
so
challenge
many.
Everybody. Yeah. It's fun. The best thing about this job is that. The surprise element, I never know, I don't have any aspirations of like, I want to play this role, I want to play that role. I love it when I get sent something or I read something that is so unexpected. And that is and that's the most exciting thing. Whether it be a Bond girl or whether it be a kidnap victim or whether it be...
Well, you've never thought about playing it before, but then you get a brilliant script and it makes you start thinking, oh, I could actually play that.
Yeah.
And that's brilliant. That's the nice part of this job is that... Everything is possible.
Yeah.
You just gotta know that.
So it doesn't sound like it's a job, quote unquote, to either one of you at this point. You're still in the blush of romance with acting and
It is a job in that it ends when you finish and then you go home. Like, we're very much similar in that respect, that we have our own lives and live in London and we don't talk about acting when we go home.
Really?
And we do our own thing. That's, in that sense, it's a job, but it's a job that we love and enjoy and are very grateful for.
Very grateful.
But it is a job, I think that's good
to
remember.
And we work very hard when you do it. It's not like, it's lots of hours and you know, but that's part of the,
that's what
you do.
That's why you love it. Yeah.
And that's why you love it. And yeah.
So how did you put this film on its feet? Did you guys do a bunch of rehearsal?
We didn't do any rehearsal, which is, you'd think with Stephen Frears, revered director, maybe he rehearses loads. He doesn't rehearse at all. He just got a really good cast together. All the components were right when he assembled it. And then he went, okay, well, let's do it now. And
it's yours now, and I'll just observe, and if I need to tweak it, I will. And that's basically what he did. And... Well, it was just nice, wasn't it? It felt very free, freeing to know that he trusted you and we trusted him to know that if we weren't doing something right, he'd tell us, you know? And it was very refreshed
fun. After doing Tamara Drewe, because there was no fuss making this movie. Mm-hmm. All of the work, you know, if you get the right things in place, and more importantly, if the script is good, if the script is... really, you know, on it, and you don't have to rewrite and change things all the time. Everyone can just get on with their job. And if you get the right cameraman, the right DP, the lot, you know, it's going to turn out right.
Yeah, all the factors were right. And I think Stephen, because he's been around and he's done so much over the years, he's worked out what he needs for something to be a smooth running machine when he makes a film. And that's one of the essential factors is the crew, which he knows by name, he knows their families, and some of them are the jokes. He makes the joke, you know, of the day. And the producers he works with have produced so many of his films.
And it all and trickles it down.
All trickles down because you come on set and everybody's happy. Everybody knows everybody, and you know, and he provides all the factors. Mm-hmm. So that he then can just allow it to run on the tracks smoothly, and then he just guides it however fast he wants it to go. Do you know what I mean? That's and
it's just hard knowledge. On something like this, because I mean, it is kind of a countryside farce.
What did you say?
Is it tone hard on something like this?
Yeah, mm. I think that lots this was the reason why it's kind of amazing. This film is because it's this completely unique, fresh tone. And it's all many different genres of film in one film. Mm. And I think if anybody else maybe tried to direct it, it could have gone horribly wrong. And it's masterfully done, and very subtly done by Stephen, because
it goes through so many different films. I mean, it has its melodramatic. Mm-hmm. It's
sometimes
dramas.
It's like a Greek tragedy or like
completely.
A saga,
and then farcical at other points. You know, and almost like a pantomime when
and then like desperately so tragic.
Fun. Yeah.
But that's the, you know, having faith in your director, because he just knew. I mean, that's why I admire him so much. Mm. He's on a different level. He can really see everything and guides it and feels it. He feels where it should go. You know, you should accentuate the caricature a bit more or play the real emotion. And it has all of these things in it. And
he works with melody. A lot. He hears a line said in a certain way, like there's a melody to it, and it's like a rhythm, and it's almost orchestrated some scenes, and he knows that it's right when it's done. He knows that there's a certain way it needs to sound, and when it gets to that sound,
he
moves on.
And he doesn't take many.
No,
I think the maximum was like six takes.
Six, yeah. I think mine was like. Four or five.
Yeah, you were better than me, so.
Well, I just had to walk a lot. I didn't have to say anything, so that is. I can walk as well, however.
But that's
you
good.
You had lines.
I had stuff to say, but he, you know, he's. I like that. He knows when to leave it alone as well, and he knows what he trusts it.
Well, Mike Newell feels like he has that same kind of energy about him on a certain level, and yet he has that giant thing around him for doing Prince of Persia. Is it comforting having somebody who is more of that tone in a big, giant movie like that?
Yeah, for me, it was like I was clinging onto Mike Newell for dear life. It's like, okay, I know the way you work and you know the way I work, and we get, you know, I needed him a lot. Right. 'Cause that whole world is so huge and quite daunting, I think, like when you're from the sort of theatre background. Mm-hmm. He was really amazing at just, you know, directing me in the way that a good director directs everybody differently on set, and he recognised the way that I needed directing, which was very intimate and internal. And I was very grateful to that. Yeah,
he's a really
great man.
And you know, he and Stephen went to college together.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, Stephen and Mike have a little bit of rivalry, and I remember when I was working with Stephen, he'd always go, "Oh, well, how would Mike Newell do it? He's a proper director." And then the other way around, Mike would be like, "Oh, you're working with Stephen now, are you? Yeah, he's really great." It's really funny that these two very revered, established directors sort of, you know, they all have their sort of little things.
God, but neither one has knighthood. This is their, both of them brought up, but they went to school with Richard Eyre, who does, because he does theater. And that's what you, I guess that's when you're, the power of being a British...
British theatre, if you want to be the aristocratic, you have to start directing Shakespeare.
Sir Richard Attenborough?
Sir Richard
Film director.
Oh, that's true.
That's true. But he has he's Dickie. Once you're Dickie, I guess you get away with anything.
Once you're Dickie. Good old Dickie. Oh, I love him.
So when the wave of attention comes, because, you know, you're theatre actors and you go and do a movie here, a little movie there, When all of a sudden there's this press blitz and you're traveling around or you know something like Clash with this giant international touring and all that stuff, is it shocking? Is it as expected? Is it?
You know what? It's a lot less than everybody makes it out to be, in my experience. Like when Clash, everyone made a big deal out of Clash and Prince of Persia, like it was going to be this huge thing, and for me it wasn't. It was I was doing a play when Clash came out, so I didn't do the big press tour. Nobody knew it was me in the film. Prince of Persia, nobody knew it was me in the film. I come here and everyone calls me Gemma. Nobody knows who I am, and it's great. I love it like that. You just can get on
long
with
may it,
it
rain, eh?
For some people, it's very different. I remember when I was working with Sam Worthington, and obviously he'd had Avatar. I mean, this is a different thing altogether. And he was like, "You get your life is going to change," and it hasn't. Mm. You know, I think it really That's does depend on the film, obviously, and the, you know, it's different. It depends on the person, the way you handle it, the way you view it.
Yeah. I have no, I mean, it's, this is all still incredibly new to me. Tamara Drewe is like the sort of the biggest thing as a leading
you
man.
You wait until Musketeers come out, your life's going to change.
Oh.
You're going to need security.
No, no.
You're going to need, you're going to need like.
Don't look at me in the eye.
You're going to need blacked out windows in your car.
Yeah, I'm going to need at least 15
You're
going
to have to move out of the
guards.
Country.
I'm going to have to like, hire a whole restaurant to have breakfast.
Yeah.
We did an interview here a few weeks ago with an Indian superstar who's like the biggest star in India right now.
Oh, yeah.
Amir Khan.
Oh, Amir Khan.
He had four bodyguards with him, and literally nobody in Los Angeles has the slightest idea. He could walk down the street and nobody
They'd obviously
know.
Heard about you.
Except for the bodyguards, right. They
heard about your reputation.
It's, like, it's a fascinating thing because I've seen the... You know, if you do a screening of a Bollywood film,
mental.
People are like hanging off the rafters, even in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
If you walk down the street tomorrow, nobody would even.
Yeah.
Do you guys get? Are you tabloided? Are you tabloid?
Yes.
At home.
Yes, I am.
You are, aren't you? I've had a little bit, only since Tamara Drewe. They called my mum and dad, which I found very weird, and tried to do an interview with my dad, which. My dad didn't know what was going on. He's like, "Oh, hello! Oh, he's doing really well. He's in Germany now, doing Three Musketeers." And sure enough, they printed it like it was an interview with him the next day when he wasn't very happy about it. But you know, it's still you live and you learn. It's a very strange thing. It's like I said, it's all still quite fresh to me. You've dealt with it for a few years now, haven't you? But it's whatever it is, isn't it? It's not.
Do you pay attention to it?
No.
It's only when people tell you about it. Like I get that a lot in interviews when they go, "Oh, look at this bad thing that's been written about you or something," and I'm like,
"What a nice, awful thing to do."
Yeah, and then I never read it because it's you know it's destructive, even if it's good.
Yeah,
it's like it doesn't really matter, you know. And it does have an effect on you if you do read it, so it's best not to. So, but yeah, I mean, it's there. I think it's very much. A big thing in the UK.
We're getting sick of it here, and yet it's much worse in the UK.
Yeah, it is. It is. Writing about very insignificant things that don't
Pointless
mean anything.
Things.
In
Pointless.
Well, I actually looked up on IMDb, and there were like things in there, and I was like, I wonder if these are real or just made up for IMDb.
They'll all be fake. It's all lies. It's all lies.
You never know. It's
press.
Like,
they're all. It's which magazines are they? That's usually the answer, isn't it?
Well, neither one of you is a Kardashian, so.
Oh.
Sorry?
You don't even know who the Kardashians are, see? You're on the wrong side of the table.
Kardashians?
This group of sisters who are bosomy and have large tushies. And
sound like a,
are
like a
very pretty, and they are on TV as reality stars.
Oh, right.
And people are completely obsessed. It's like 24/7.
Oh, really?
Of the effects here.
Kardashians, it
here
sounds
they are.
Like...
Are they the Kardashians?
The Kardashian sisters on the cover of a magazine.
Oh.
Whose only claim to fame is being famous.
Wow, I want to be like them.
Proud moments.
I'm going to change my life and be like them.
Wow, look at the colour of their skin.
I'm going to have surgery like that.
Well, one of them had a sex tape. This all kind of started with a sex tape with one of the sisters.
Oh, we should do a sex tape.
Had sex
tape.
With a...
now
that's going to be the tabloids next week.
That's awesome. Let's do a sex tape.
Is that what you
then
do?
Then we'll get on the front of LA Confidential.
Is that what you do to get famous?
It's not very confidential though, is it?
It seems confidential
until
you look at the
Hello!
Let's show you.
Come to my home.
But did they do sex tapes with each other?
No, there was just one of them did the sex tape. The other two kind of came along for the ride.
Who was the sex tape with?
It was, I think, actually, it was somebody named Ray J, who is a rapper.
Oh. Dear.
And he has his own reality show on VH1 here in the US.
Sex
also.
Tapes are not so big in the UK, are they? So anything. I don't know any famous person who's got a sex tape.
I think everybody
Why are we
Big
talking
Brother
about this?
He brought it up. We were having a really interesting interview. Now you've turned it into
down
a filthy. Oh, I don't know.
So, were you both, you were saying before that your way of doing these things is you finish doing the work and then you kind of move on emotionally.
Yeah.
Are you both that way? Is that the...
Yeah.
Depends on the film, again.
Mm-hmm.
I there are some
sometimes
films
it's easy,
when you just go, okay, bye,
yeah,
and you go
done.
And it's easy to drop it. With some films, they stay with you, actually.
Mm.
like even Tamara Drewe, I still find myself thinking about it. And I did another film which really stayed with me for a while. I had to shake it off. But it really depends how much you invest and use, you know, but certain aspects of yourself. Mm. Just depends.
Yeah. Do you watch yourself when it comes up on cable or whatever?
When I first started acting, which wasn't long ago, I used to be really excited about watching a movie that I was in. Mm. And then as time progresses, you become more under more scrutiny, and then you scrutinize yourself more. Mm. It becomes harder. I've seen Tamara Drewe like once.
Oh, yeah.
Through like this.
Yeah.
And it, I don't know, it sounds really wanky to say it, but actually it's not, for me, I just speak for myself, it doesn't really do anything, because it's never going to be as good as the experience that you had or what you think it's going to be, because, it's nice to actually just sit with the the sort of memory of it.
My family, all my family, just not my mum and dad, but my cousins, and they still are excited to see an advert of Tamara Drewe on the TV.
Oh.
Because I'm in the advert. I mean, it's still that novel to them. Mm-hmm. I'm sure it'll wear off, but right
yeah,
now...
Yeah, like my parents are like, oh, God.
I get a phone call every other day going, oh, he just saw your advert. And it's like, great.
My parents are like, do you want to come to the premiere of Tamara Drewe? And they went, oh, can I just wear that dress that I wore before? I really can't be bothered to find anything.
Ah, that's brilliant.
That's really sweet, though, because they're so over it.
She was in the hairdressers at 7 o'clock in the morning having her hair done, so she could catch the bus for 4 hours to London
with her hair done
for the night at the 8 o'clock premiere.
That's
at night.
That's really sweet.
So sweet, so sweet. You gotta love the little Welsh people.
Yeah, they're so sweet. Your family.
So that must be one of the best parts of doing this.
Oh,
yeah.
I mean, yeah, it's bringing. And I think I said this to you the other week when we were at the premiere. It's the only time in a film, when you do theatre, people can come for months on end. Right. You know, they can come whenever they want. You do it 8 times a week. With the film, it's a very personal thing. You know, you're on set. People can visit, but it rarely happens. And you do the film and it finishes, and it's like almost a year sometimes before it comes out. And the premiere is the only time you can really share it with your loved ones and your friends. And so I realized how important it was to be there in London and have my friends there and my cousins. It was just really special. And to see their faces, for me, was more important than walking down the red carpet myself. Mm-hmm. And it was brilliant. You're the same, aren't you?
Yeah.
Just watching them, it's just lovely to see them experience these things that just usually see on...
My dad's like a pro now at all this stuff.
He's
like,
brilliant.
He goes
your
up
dad.
To directors and he's like, pleasure to meet you, mate.
He knows everyone.
Hey, Stephen, just want to say... Really big fan.
Yeah.
Really big fan of your work. I'm like, Dan, have you really seen any of it? Any other of it? But he's really good at it all now. He's become like this,
God, I love
you know.
Him.
It's really sweet. It's really sweet.
He educated my dad, I think, when they met once on set.
Yeah. Our dads came on set on Tamara Drewe. And they were looked after, like...
Oh, they loved it.
It was
my
brilliant.
Dad loved the food as well.
Yeah, free food.
The catering is, like, great, and it was free.
They love the free food.
You can always go back for seconds, which they love. And
Dad's like, well, I have a cheeky second dessert.
Is that all right?
Nobody else is eating it. So.
Oh, I love it. Love it. Makes it all... Brings you back to reality, you know? We see somebody appreciate that, things like that.
Yeah.
Catering really is the first thing that gets boring on a movie set, though, isn't it?
No, not for me, it isn't. I love
it. On Tamara Drewe, the catering was great.
Oh, it was awesome. The dessert. But I couldn't...
Do you know what? If you want to make a good movie, just make sure the food's good, because then everyone turns up with
always
joy
happy.
In their hearts.
Yeah.
And they're really looking forward to being there each day.
Oh, without a
and
doubt.
And people are happy.
Yeah. As long as there's jam, roly poly, and custard on the dessert menu, I am a happy man.
Yeah.
So you already know the trick of being a director. Yeah,
there you go.
It's simple.
I get it now.
Basically.
That's it.
Yeah.
Just always have nice food there.
It is true, though, about food.
So is food your takeaway from Tamara Drewe? Is that what you'll remember forever?
There was some amazing food on Tamara Drewe, because Tamsin's character, Beth, makes all this all these beautiful cakes. And all these scones.
Oh my God, they were amazing.
Lots
of
cream, and there was all this amazing food going around.
Bill Cabot, all the most time. Of it.
He ate all the food.
God, every scene he's got something in his mouth.
Yeah.
It's literally like he's a scone. It's just unbelievable. His mouth is always full.
Yeah. No. I think, honestly, out of Tamara Drewe, getting out of Tamara Drewe, Stephen's approach to how it is, the refreshing, kind of simplistic, instinctive way of working is what I got out of it.
Yeah. I'd work with him again tomorrow. We all would.
Yeah,
we?
If he'd have
it was,
us.
If he'd have us, he probably wouldn't. But it was a really special experience. And I'm the envy of all my acting friends because I've had that chance. It's, you know, that's what I take from it. And also, friends.
Yeah.
It is funny that he doesn't bring back the same people over and over again.
He does, though, but with time. I think. I mean, he worked with Roger Allam, who plays Nicholas in The Queen, and then he worked with Michelle Pfeiffer twice, after like 20 years, I think.
Yeah. Mm.
He does work with people again.
He does.
But I think that's, you know, thinking
but
about the way...
But only if it's right, I think.
Yeah, only if it's right. And he likes new things, he likes surprise, and so, you know...
Which is a great thing in a guy in his 70s.
Amazing. Yeah.
Likes change all the time.
Yeah.
Exciting.
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys very much. Appreciate
thank
it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hope it wasn't too painful.
It wasn't. It was lovely. You.